feedback, so you can not be on stage. But before anything else, please join me in prayer in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So welcome back to the Love is Possible with God. It's good to see you guys. I'm Alan Cousin, and we're very excited for tonight's topic. It's obviously a very important topic, because there's a lot of polarized things happening out there, and most of us thought it was important to talk about the issue of the Catholic voting principles. And we've got two phenomenal speakers with us today. Just a quick housekeeping, there are bathrooms in the back. We just ask you to use, we have 1% of time in the restroom. We introduce our panelists, if you will. First is Ed Mechmann, he's the director of the Public Policy Office and the City Cloud Diary Program in the Archdiocese of New York. He has a BA from Columbia and a JD from Harvard, and an MA from St. Joseph's Seminary. He's a former federal prosecutor and is an active member of St. John's Church and volunteers for his life and community. So please welcome Ed Mechmann. And right next to him is Alexis, he is the assistant to the director of the Public Policy Office and the City Environment Program at the Archdiocese of New York. She has a BA and MA and a KD from Fordham, and she's the founder of Discussion and Discipleship. And if you've not been part of the Discussion and Discipleship group yet, maybe Alexis is there, you can just talk about it. It's a phenomenal group, showing up in many ways and involved in it. And she's an active member of the parish. She's really gotten engaged in the study of the roots. Woo!
Shape it so that the common good is served, so that social justice And we're going to talk a little bit about the candidates and can you be a Catholic argument for Trump, a Catholic argument for Biden, what's the deal with the abortion, she has that factor in, and we can talk a little bit about the viability of third party candidates. But before we do that, it really is important to stress these overarching philosophical points, because really when we enter the voting booth and we vote for a particular party, a candidate, a platform, we have to think about, is this something that is going to make it easier for me or harder for me to enter a current body? And the same thing that goes, I think, likewise in a similar sense, is there a specific party, a candidate, a platform? Like, what is their impact on the church? Well, the church is mostly influential in leading people to eternal life. So is a party, a candidate, a platform going to make it more difficult or make it harder for the church to lead people to eternal life? Now, a few other points. I think a lot of people in general have this notion of separation of church and state. So, okay, therefore we should keep our religion separate from our politics and, you know, they're very, very distinct categories. But when we talk about authenticity as a human person, authenticity as a Catholic, my Catholic identity doesn't suddenly, you know, run away escaping me when I enter the voting. So, of course, that's something else that we need to keep in mind. Just like it doesn't escape me when I do all these other things throughout my life, you know, there's a unity here in terms of our identity. Few more points, introductory points. The sources of information. Now, this, and we love to talk about this. So we'll get a few different Catholic voting guides sent to our office. But these are voting guides that usually are put out by partisan groups. They're agenda-driven, and they reach drastically different conclusions. So it almost seems to be like, what's the story? What does the church actually teach, and why is it that all these different groups are sending us all these voting guides that are reaching different conclusions? What should I believe as a Catholic?
Yeah, it's almost like one of those movies, turning art movies, where you see the same event from five different perspectives, and it's like, wait a minute, I kind of understood what's going on in American politics, at least in a completely different world than I am. So it's very strange.
Yeah, absolutely. So getting the sort of true and correct information about church guidance on voting is very, very important. So during this discussion, we're going to reference three main sources, but specifically this document here. I have it right here, I brought it with me. It's Forming Consciousness for Faithful Citizenship. I don't know, many of you have heard of it, seen of it, I'm not really sure, but it's actually a useful document. It's put out by the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops, and it does address exactly what this conversation is about. What are the Catholic principles for voting? What issues should Catholics be taking into consideration? And as a lot of people keep that in mind, because a lot of people, you know, they'll quote certain priests, certain bishops, and they'll say, this is what the church teaches, but it's really not. So we have to be very mindful of that.
We also have to be careful, I think, a lot of times to see people online or wherever, who are priests, or religious, or whatever, and they're telling you who to go for, or they'll be telling you not to go for. That's not the bishop. The bishops follow what Pope Francis said, which is the job of the church is to form consciousness, not to replace them. So what the bishops are doing is not doing very well. They lay out the basic principles, and then they start going through the various blocks of issues, groups of issues, to explain how to apply the Catholic position to those. But they don't tell us who to vote for. And I think that's important because it shows respect for our free will and for our responsibility. If I am the one who has to stand before Jesus and explain how I voted and how I acted in this life, I can't blame other bishops.
Yes, that is very true. So what we're going to do now, especially right now, I'm actually going to take the time to very, very briefly go through these seven principles that the bishops actually set out for us. And then we're going to talk a little bit about abortion. Ed's going to go ahead and start our discussion about Trump, Biden, etc. So, I don't know if anyone has heard this document, but I'm going to walk through the seven principles from here now and there, so you might as well do that now. So, the first principle, which I don't think is a surprise, that the church talks about, the bishops talk about, is the right to life and the dignity of the human person. And there's two specific portions that I want to know.
we're going to go into the second theme that the church talks about. And that has to do with call to family, community, and participation. And the bishops say here, the family, based on marriage between a man and a woman, is the first and fundamental unit of the society. And then they continue, it should be defended and strengthened, not redefined or undermined by permitting same-sex unions, or other distortions of marriage. Then it also says the need to uphold parental rights and responsibilities, especially for choosing education for children.
And this is also one of these bedrock principles that you can see the logic of. The strength of families is essential to the strength of society. If families are being undermined, then society is going to have major problems. And we can just see this from our social science and the history of the United States, especially in the last 75 years or so. This is also rooted in the true nature of the human person, made male and female in the image of God. I know our society does not quite agree with that anymore. We seem to be going off in strange directions about sex and gender. But we hold very clearly to this position because we think the logic, just the logic of it and the lived experience of it, of a healthy marriage and a healthy family, it's the best place to raise children, and that is the best original cell or basic foundation of a healthy society.
Mm-hmm. And then from there, it also, the bishops talk about other rights that we get and we should be concerned about. So in this category, topic number three, they talk about every human being has a right to life, which was mentioned, and that's the fundamental right that makes all other rights that we should be concerned about possible. So, a right to access those things required for human dignity, food and shelter, education and employment, health care and housing, freedom of religion and family, and the right to exercise religious freedom publicly and privately need to be constantly defended. So, of course, we're starting obviously with the right to life, but then from this right to life, the church is deriving this whole other set of rights that we also need to be concerned about.
And this is also, this category in particular, I think, is difficult for a lot of Americans, especially to hear and to understand. You know, our culture has developed a kind of an ideology of individual autonomy, that I'm completely independent of everyone else, that I do not have any duties or responsibilities to them, but everybody's got to respect my rights. And especially some of those things that the church mentions, right, the health care and things like that, that is very, very sensitive to a lot of people in America who are bought into this libertarian economic model where it's every man for himself, which is essentially, you know, Darwinism among humans, where the survival of the fittest and the rest suffer. And that certainly can't be a Christian way of looking at things. The Holy Father just published a letter, Fratelli Tutti, we are all brothers and sisters, and how we have to build a fraternal society. And if we don't recognize these rights and responsibilities to each other, there's no way that we can develop that kind of society.
Yes. And then from that, it makes perfect sense, because then the next principle the bishops talk about is this preferential option for the poor and vulnerable. And I think that that's interesting because, like Ed was saying, we're very accustomed to voting in a self-interested way. Like, this is specifically my interest, what I care about. And, you know, I don't really care about other groups that don't really impact me. So the church is challenging us to also take into account how our voting choices really are going to impact the poor and the vulnerable. So, of course, it's the bishops teach, while the common good embraces all, those who are weak, vulnerable, most need this preferential concern. And they continue on to say, the preferential option for the poor and vulnerable includes all who are marginalized in our nature and beyond. Unborn children, persons with disabilities, the elderly and terminally ill, and the victims of injustice and oppression.
Yeah, and this is also an extremely challenging topic. We Americans are very pragmatic, and it's very difficult to cast public policies that would authentically help people rise out of poverty. Very often we tend to fall back again on this economic libertarian view well, pull yourself up by your bootstraps, and if you don't, it's your fault. Or there are policies that really basically put people into a state of dependency on the government, and squash their initiatives. One of the worst ones is in a lot of our social welfare policies, there are basically penalties for people who get married. If they get married, they lose benefits. And that's just a perverse kind of thing. Marriage is one of the great ladders to prosperity. When people get married, they pool together their economic and social resources, and it really strengthens them. And if we're not working to help those people who are marginalized, single parents, single people who are looking for marriage, and all of our poor people, I mean, just look around outside on the street here, we're very far off as a society. And you know, poor people don't have lobbyists on K Street in Washington. A lot of other people do. You know, when Mark Zuckerberg goes down to Washington to lobby people, he gets a lot of attention. But when poor people are sitting homeless outside of the U.S. Capitol, they don't. And there's something wrong with that.
Yes. Okay. Now, next, similar in focus, is this, I guess, concern for dignity of work and the rights of workers. And this is where the bishop says, the bishops talk about the economy, and they say the economy must serve people, not the other way around. And it says the rights of workers to productive work, to decent and just wages, to adequate benefits and security in their old age, and the choice of whether or not to unionize. So again, there's this focus on workers and well-being, which is again not something that is always in, I guess, the forefront of in our discussions on economics.
Right. Yeah, that tends to be dominated by profit fixation, which is important. People deserve to make a profit from their productive work. There's no question about that. But a lot of times the health and the safety and the well-being of the workers is a secondary, at best, concern. And there are ways of fostering greater cooperation between management and labor, to use some old-fashioned terms. One of the good things we do is every Friday, there's the jobs report, and everybody looks at that as a sign of the health of the economy. That's a good idea. But we need to take that further and make sure, is everybody able to get a job? There's a lot of people who have given up already. And are those good quality jobs that can support a family? Are they getting a living wage and appropriate benefits? And, you know, the gig economy, a lot of times some people left out there, you know, you're on your own, you're an independent contractor, the heck with you. So this is an important feature of any good social policy.
Yes. Okay, so two more left, and then we'll get interested. So the sixth theme is this theme of solidarity, and the bishops talk about loving our neighbor has a global dimension, so it requires us to eradicate racism and address the extreme poverty and disease plaguing so much of the world. Solidarity also includes the scriptural call to welcome the stranger among us, including immigrants seeking work, etc., etc. So that's not really a surprise.
No, solidarity has been a major theme in the church for a long time. I'm sure you remember, or many of you are too young to remember, Pope John Paul, was one of the major themes of his pontificate, is solidarity across borders and within borders. It's again, a challenging concept, because it forces us to think beyond some of the boundaries that we create around ourselves. A lot of times we tend to focus on people who are like us, and we view the other as the enemy, or to reject people who are coming from other places because they don't look like us and they don't sound like us. Certainly the horrendous legacy of racism in the United States is a direct violation of even the most fundamental notion of solidarity. But it's challenging to people to get out of that boundary and to look at ourselves and at other people, our brothers and sisters everywhere, through the eyes of God. And through the eyes of God, we are all brothers and sisters. And the challenge is to act on.
Okay, so now we're at the final principle, which is caring for creation. So we have a moral obligation to protect the planet in which we live and serve as stewards. Okay, so great. We walked through all these principles, and I remember the first time I did this, I was like, this is nice, this sounds very idealistic, but it doesn't seem realistic, or it seems to be that this is what we're trying to find the perfect candidate, and there's no possible candidate that could live up to all these principles. So you're, after reading this, I was like, okay, you know, we need a sense to prioritize these issues. How do I know what matters more? Because the church is laying out all these different areas of concerns, but what matters more? And how do I make tough decisions where there's not ideal Catholics? Like, obviously, this is the blueprint that Catholics need to be forming our conscience, we need to be thinking about these issues from this specific perspective. You know, when the candidates are falling short in some respect, what do you do? Now, this is where it gets controversial for some people, even Catholics. See, in this document, and even in general, if we look at a lot of like Vatican documents, magisterial documents, authoritative documents, not just, you know, some random perspective, there is, whether people like it or not, a focus on life issues in terms of abortion. And this is where the church, you know, I guess even most Catholics gets this reputation that, oh, you lay out all these important principles, but then you just say abortion matters the most. So then what do you do about that? And some Catholics, that makes perfect sense, as it should, but for others it seems very difficult because they may be inclined to vote for a candidate that favors abortion, has a platform that's going to expand abortion, but yet they believe that he or she has other redeeming qualities. So then what do you do? And that's a dilemma that a lot of Catholics, not all, because plenty of Catholics don't face this dilemma, but some Catholics really in good faith experience. And there doesn't seem to be an easy answer, but the church does provide some guidance. Now, I don't know, you want to make some points?
No, go for it. No.
Okay.
No, I think actually you have to always prioritize a lot, right? But some things are more important than others. And the church wants us to be focusing on the most grave threat to human life and our principles, all the principles, is the threat of abortion. It violates every single one of those principles that we're talking about. Even the care of creation violates this. Pope Francis said, if we don't care for the unborn child in the womb, how can we be expected to care for God's creation? If we're willing to throw away that child, aren't we going to treat our creation the same way? So again, it's a challenging thing, and it's hard, especially if all the candidates are imperfect. But it's something that the church wants us to always keep in mind and not set aside. Because it'd be very easy to just say, abortion is legal in the United States, let's just look at other issues. That's not an acceptable way of doing things according to the church.
Yeah. And we're going to delve right into it. Because, again, there's a lot of opinions and perspectives, you know, put out online or in other documents. But this question is actually answered. The bishops do answer this question. And I'm going to really go into what they say, because people need to know for better or for worse. So the short answer that the church teaches is that under the vast majority of circumstances, Catholics cannot vote for candidates that support, promote abortion, etc., unless they really have a proportionately serious, grave moral reason. Now, of course, people might say, well, what is that? What's a truly grave proportional reason? But the church even provides some guidance as to what that is. Of course, they won't give us a direct answer. The church can't, you know, endorse certain candidates, but they do give us some guidance. So the documents that I'm referencing, because I feel like people constantly check us, because if people don't like the answer, they'll check us. But, you know,
check the footnotes. Whatever
at this point. So the section that we're referencing is section 35 in this USCCB document. But also, there's a notorious letter written by then Cardinal Ratzinger to ex-Cardinal Carra that talks about this. And it was in the context of worthiness to receive communion. Now, you know, politicians, like if they promote certain policies, whatever, et cetera, that are contrary to strategic, can they receive communion? And in this document, which is originally a private letter that became publicly leaked, Ratzinger, he makes two important comments, and that's what the church's stance developed. So,
and just to put that in context, this is in 2004. It was the first time that we were faced with an election where a Catholic candidate, John Kerry, was openly pro-choice. So it was creating a lot of controversy and a lot of anxiety in the church. And the bishops needed an answer, and that's why they sought an opinion from Cardinal Ratzinger.
Yes. So this is what Cardinal Ratzinger says. He says at the bottom of this letter, he says, when a Catholic does not share a candidate's stand in favor of abortion and or euthanasia, but votes for that candidate for other reasons, it is considered remote material quality cooperation, which can be permitted in the presence of proportionate reasons. But then in the body of his letter, he actually lists that certain issues do have priority. And this is briefly what he says. He says, not all moral issues have the same moral weight as abortion and euthanasia. So for example, if a Catholic were to be at odds with the Holy Father on the application of Catholic punishment or on a decision to wage war, he would not, for that reason, be considered unworthy to present himself to receive Holy Communion. So here, Benedict, or at that time Ratzinger, is making a distinction between issues. But again, you know, what does that leave for Catholics here today dealing with these issues? It just seems to be how, you know, this debate really hinges on, do you have a proportionate reason or not? And that is very, very difficult to assess.
Right, so shall I go ahead and do my
intervention? Sure, if you want, yeah, there you go.
Okay, so what we decided to do at this point was to take the principles from faithful citizenship and then see if we can make a Catholic argument that would justify supporting Mr. Biden or Mr. Trump. Okay. Now, I have to say, of course, this is a legal disclaimer. We are not endorsing candidates. We are not endorsing candidates. We're not telling you who to vote for. This is a thought experiment, really. And a lot of it is my opinion, and I'm not going to. It's more the way I basically did this analysis. As a thought experiment.
So I guess we need to say that, you know, Catholics, they don't even have a moral obligation to reach the same conclusions that Ed and I reach. But I think it's important, you do have a moral obligation to form your consciences in this light based on these guiding principles of our faith. And I think it's worthwhile at least to think about, for a matter of a thought experiment at the very least, to work through and apply these principles to the actual candidates that we're facing, you know, for Biden, for Trump, and then what we're also going to talk about is a third-party candidate. Like, is that worthwhile? Is that wasting a vote? You know, what do we do in that sense?
And we actually have come to different conclusions about some of this stuff, too, so even we're not in agreement. So, you know, I guess I have to apologize. I'm a lawyer. I'm sorry. It's not my fault. I guess it was. But, so I tend to think like a lawyer. Okay, I'm sorry about that. She's a lawyer, too. Actually, I'm an attorney because I've been admitted to the bar. She's only a lawyer because she took the bar, but she hasn't been admitted.
I haven't gotten her
So there. Anyway, fancy. So, what I like to think about, then, is the way that lawyers talk about burdens of proof and presumption. You know, the burden of proof is how much evidence you have to bring forward in order to prove a point, right? So in the criminal context, you have to bring enough evidence to convince the jury beyond a reasonable doubt. That's a very high standard. In a civil case, you have to bring enough evidence to convince the judge or the jury by a preponderance of the evidence. And that's based on a 51-49, you know, there's enough, just a little more evidence for as opposed to against. So I think about that. And I also think about the legal concept of a presumption. A presumption is it's a presumption. I mean, the presumed answer, the default answer, is one particular thing. So in a criminal case, there's a presumption of innocence. So the default is he's innocent until you prove it beyond a reasonable doubt that he's guilty. You get that? That's the way that we think. So to me, when I look at the teaching of the bishop, they say that if a candidate favors an intrinsic moral evil, which is one of those things that can never be good ever, so, you know, abortion, racism, genocide, torture, things like that, that under no circumstances can be good. If a candidate favors that, there's a presumption that I can't vote for him unless I have a truly grave moral reason, and that's the burden of proof. Now, again, to me, truly grave moral reason sounds like a really high burden of proof.
Beyond reasonable doubt.
I think it's close to beyond a reasonable doubt as you can get. It means there's got to be a lot of good reason for me to do that. Because again, I have to go and explain to Jesus why I did that, right? And with a clear conscience, hopefully. And hopefully with his approval as well. So it should be hard. It should be hard for us to do that. A Catholic with a well-formed conscience should shun any evil, right? We should do everything we can to oppose evil. We should do everything we can to prevent evil. So it should be hard to justify it. So let's do my thought experiment then, how I thought through the two candidates. And let's start with Mr. Biden, because he's the challenger. We'll start, I guess, with some of the negative things, because he does favor some things that are intrinsic moral evil. He's all in on Roe versus Wade. He said that many, many times, which means he believes that it should be legal to have an abortion all 9 months of pregnancy for any reason whatsoever. That's what Roe v. Wade actually holds. He also believes, as he said, that taxpayers should fund every abortion. Previously, there was a thing called the Hyde Amendment. There still is the Hyde Amendment, thank God, which says that the federal government won't spend taxpayer dollars on abortions unless it's necessary for the life of a mother or it's rape or incest, which are vanishingly rare cases. Now, here, unfortunately, in pro-abortion New York, our government has already paid for abortions, 120,000 or so, it's a little bit less than that now, every year. He believes in that. He says he will appoint judges who will ensure that. In fact, he will ask them if they will uphold Roe v. Wade before he will even appoint them. His running mate has said, which is actually unconstitutional, she said that the federal government will step in to invalidate any state law that infringes upon Roe v. Wade. She's not saying it articulately. What she really means is that the Justice Department, the Solicitor General of the United States, will go into court and argue that all of these state laws that regulate or restrict abortion are unconstitutional. So you'll have the government of the United States putting its finger in the scale on the side of a pro-abortion result. He's also said that he does not believe in broad religious exemptions. This goes back to Alexis's point about
religious freedom.
Can the church operate as the church? He said that he's opposed to those. Certainly, his party is. You know, when you elect a candidate, you don't just elect a man or a woman, right? You elect a party, you elect a program, and you elect cabinet officers, undersecretaries, sub-undersecretaries, all of these people who implement policies. You will actually elect a lot of people just by voting for one person. And it is very clear, because the Democratic Party has radicalized on the question of abortion and religious freedom over the last few years, that going into a Biden-Harris administration, they will be very aggressive in promoting abortion rights and very aggressive in not enforcing religious liberties. Okay, so that's, I don't think I'm saying anything that's unusual, that's all right out there. And in fact, they don't mind, who knows it. So they talk about it openly. That's a lot of intrinsic evil there.
What are you even saying about his support of various different types of gender ideology and those, what the implications of those policies would be?
Yeah, just the other day he said that 8-year-old children should be allowed to do gender transition, which means undergo mutilating surgery on their sexual organs. And that's a pretty radical position and a really intrinsically evil thing. Now, on the other side, of course, there's the positives. Mr. Biden, generally speaking, I think a lot of people feel that he is a pretty decent fellow, although I think there's other issues with his character, particularly his penchant for making up stories about his prior, earlier life. You wonder whose life is he's talking about sometimes. Of course, Joe may be not 100% with us at times, but that's okay. But he generally, I think, people point to a lot of his positions that would be more in line with the positions that the bishops outline in faithful citizenship, certainly on immigration and migrants and refugees. I'll talk about it in a second, but Mr. Trump is a disaster on those issues, and Mr. Biden is much better, the Democratic Party would be much better on those. Certainly on areas of fighting poverty and ensuring health care for people and things like that are much more akin with the kinds of things the bishops would propose. Those are pragmatic issues. Those are not issues of good and evil. But he would generally, I think, promote issues that are more akin to what we would, the bishops would. He certainly would lower the temperature on race issues in the United States and not inflame them the way that that Mr. Trump is doing. It's a funny thing, too, though. You notice that even I'm doing it. I'm making the argument for him by saying he's not the other guy. He's not as bad as the other guy. Now, that can be a legitimate argument, but I read a lot of stuff, and especially from a Catholic perspective, and most of the Catholic arguments about in favor of voting for Mr. Biden come down to he's rational and Trump is not, he's nicer and Trump is nasty and things like that, which, by the way, I don't deny either at this point, but is that a truly grave moral reason to justify voting for someone who thinks it should be legal to kill 750,000 plus children every year? Every year. 3 million children over the course of a 4-year administration. That's the population, I think, pretty much of Queens. Right? Do we really want to wipe out Queens every 4 years? Is the nastiness, is the turning down of the racial temperature, that's the closest call for me, is the turning down of the racial temperature. Is the closest that I can come, I think, to a truly great moral reason. But to focus on that really would require me to ignore the evil of abortion, set it aside, I think. And the bishops say specifically that I can't make political decisions in order to ignore the fundamental moral evil. And being right on other issues is not acceptable if you're wrong on the issue. So I have a very hard time though, and I think it would be to really learn the proof that it would be a truly grave moral reason for the presumption that I can't justify him because he favors so many forms of intrinsic evil. So I personally, the negatives are just too high. Let me go to the other side and take questions at the end. Make it really interesting with him. The negatives we all know, the character is abominable. The whole public office in the States. He's disgusting, he's cruel, a repeated liar. Has no respect whatsoever for the law, does not understand the nature of his office, his legacy is poisoning of American politics. Unfortunately, I think the president has gotten very close to him, and the have gotten very close to him. They're going to have a hard time living that down. They're so him. He's a very, very politic. He likes to talk about how he's the most pro-life president. No, I don't think so. Maybe one of the most presidents, the most pro-life president. To be pro-life, you have to be against abortion. You say, only Biden is more president. That's nonsense. Abortion. But I don't seem to respect any of the black. So I don't really reject the idea that he his immigration policy, I think, is cruel. I think it's racist, certainly in its effect. American law, it violates national law, it violates international law. And I believe that his immigration is intrinsically evil. The bishops would agree with me on that. He is deliberately inflaming the race. There's no question, I think, about that. Intrinsically evil. And also on some of the military matters, bombing civilians, starting the wars, nuking. So how about him then? That's a pretty strong presumption that I can vote for him because of the interest to overcome that presumption. Supporters will point to he has been in particular been very on the abortion.
He's appointing judges, I think, that are more likely to rule according to the rule of law rather than to the whims of contemporary political opinion. That's what the Amy Coney Barrett hearing for really about with originalism, deciding things based on the original meaning of the Constitution, as opposed to what the contemporary political platform happens to be. He has been good. His administration has been good in resistance of the gender ideology. The stuff that's been going through. So is there a truly great moral reason? So how do I add up to a truly great moral reason? Those things he's done, and then the damage is more. You know, it's likely to be less harm than the other. To me, this is a really, really close call. I personally believe
might happen if this weren't a tragedy. Yes, sir.
Yeah, and see, I disagree with that because I reject the idea that there's a binary thing. It's a false binary. That do I have to vote for one or the other? I can't vote for him, I have to vote for the other. That's a big argument to me, actually. You say, well, you can't vote for Biden, you can't vote for Trump, or Trump's a racist, you can't vote for him, you gotta vote for Biden. I reject that false binary because there are alternatives. They should even recognize that you may decide not to vote. Don't reward them by voting for any of these lousy candidates. I think if you keep on voting for lousy candidates, they'll keep giving these lousy candidates. But I think there are other candidates. I'm in favor of the American.
voting for another party, and a candidate would very well have a chance to vote for the other, you know, alternative candidate who's more favorable to religious freedom. But then, you know, we don't, for a host of reasons, and that other that bad candidate gets elected. So now you're in a situation, this is actually real, and I do work for the church, where it's actually hard for the church to operate.
But the flaw in your argument is that you're assuming that I do to vote for the other major party candidate. Thank you. these things, it's hard to predict where a candidate is going to go in the future. It is. You try to look at their past record and the indications that they've made a campaign record. The Republican Party doesn't really have a platform this year. They kind of perform on re-adopted last time's platform, and then to Trump put out some talking points of his own. But I think you also have to look to, and what I was thinking of was certainly general tone, a desire to reach into the African American community, which is Trump doesn't seem to have any concept of, and the kind of people who go into the administration. So that was what I was thinking
about. Specifically, the policies that will likely be enacted, and again, the people, again, when we talk about candidates, but the people that they're going to surround themselves with, and the other policies that are likely to be enacted, of course, that the question of actually things getting voted by virtue of the Senate and, you know, Congress overall. But that's how I would assess it. I would take into account the past, obviously, because you can't forget the past. Just how candidates are acting, more specifically, what is likely to happen in the future based on more concrete evidence of who's likely to be accompanied in policies that can come out of a certain administration.
Well, look, what you make is very important. It is very important. So what people are going to do if there's inconsistency in the past. I'll just say one more thing and then we'll move on to the next question. I'm not black. I'm not a member of the black community. I think it's valuable to listen to the black community about how they feel about which candidate will be more sensitive to racial disparities and racism. So I got to listen to them and to me.
Hey, I want to know your thoughts about more environmental issues. Climate change specifically just doesn't seem to really address that. I think the effects of that, the consequences of those, what we do right now will end up causing a lot of pro-life discussion.
Well, certainly address it unless it's less principle in the fecal system to document, or the bishop do talk about that for at least 3 paragraphs, obviously we have to out of sleep. Obviously on the environmental human health. So I think as a basic point, that's something that Catholics should be concerned about. And I think that's really derived from really biblical principles of being stewards of creation, understanding that we should not be leaving our earth in a worse condition than it right is. Now I guess the question is, okay, is that really a pro-life issue? How does that square with our things? I think in terms of the environment, the church needs a lot of room for prudential judgment and says that it's not a black and white issue about, okay, obviously you cannot be in favor of abortion, but obviously there also is some sort of obligation to care about the environment. But there is a little bit more, especially you could say, a gray area in the sense of how does that actually look like, what those policies actually will be. It's not as clear, but I don't think it's not important. I mean, it is specifically listed in the document. There's been the philosophy cynical about it. But again, it's left to, I think, more financial judgment.
Yeah, it's not an issue that I pay a lot of attention to because I'm a scientist and I kind of don't understand some of the arguments and I don't understand the impacts of the policy. But, you know, it's clear that Mr. Trump does not have any regard for the theory of climate change. Clearly rejects it. It's a shame because the Republican Party historically was a conservationist and environmentally sensitive party. President Nixon is the one who signed the law that creating the Environmental Protection Agency. So it's like a bit of a betrayal of the Republican principles. I think it's a significant issue. I think it's something that we should be paying attention to. Actually, on my list, I was taking a little time, so you might have been doing bad things about Mr. Trump. So I admit it, I'm sorry. I think it's important. As Alexis says, it's an enormously complex problem. And it's just, I think, very hard to see.
A lot
direct one question to each. For A, we talked about getting sources of information, let's talk about that shared documents. Where, in terms of sources of information for Catholic voting, where would we put the Twitter account of certain well-known priests, one in particular, who people will know that won't have the name. And for Alexis, the question I have to you is, can you talk about Catholic identity and the, basically, you guys disagree because you are reading the same document and just coming to a different conclusion about applying the principles. Would you agree that the reason most Catholics disagree is really because we've subordinated our Catholic identity to our preferred political party?
So I disagree with you guys.
Fuck anyone.
Okay. So I think that Twitter is evil except Catholic as a spiritual.
Because the church is very clear, my Catholic identity is at the forefront, that's the conclusion.
beginning of life is in the states to make sure that restrictions and regulations are going through the right direction there, and at the end of life, also in the states, and in our own rights. That's where the real world is being done. And how I vote really can have an effect on the former states, you know, here in New York, but my personal life has to do with the other. I think anything that we do that reaffirms our Catholic identity, if you talk about us, I think every time we reaffirm our Catholic identity, we strengthen our ability to act according to the will of God. And both beginning of life and ending of life, I think that's what it does.
But I mean, this question was specifically, Chris, you were saying, in terms of abortion, I think that there is a legitimate consequence of having a future administration that could be murdering more innocent lives. So I don't know how then, you know, it's not like a magic wand where you're going to have this magical caddy and I'm going to vote for them, all of a sudden abortion is going to end. So that's definitely not the case. But I think, though, we can really see that a certain candidate can and will increase the number of abortions being worse. So that's also needs to be kept in perspective. That's why I don't think, you're not going to have this magical candidate, but there are some real practical implications that your decision and your vote will facilitate.
Yes, you have to remember, since Roe v. Wade was decided in 1973, let's see, how many years is that? That's 47 years? Right? 47 years? I think we've had Republican presidents for somewhere around 30 of those years. And I think that we have probably three quarters of the Supreme Court judges in 30 years' time have been nominated by Republicans. So the assumption that abortion will get a vote for a Republican is denied by the evidence.
Gracias.